is also going to be really perfect.
We want to invite some of our friends up.
So we heard that the theme of the month is about respecting and loving other cultures, and out of sheerest coincidence, it's exactly the song I wrote called Reach with that same message. And, we get four singers on this one, it's going to be awesome.
Happy birthday, dear Cathy. Happy birthday.
Song called Reach. At the end, if you want to hold out your hand with us, you can do it.
Reaching out my hand to the other side, help me understand what you need to survive. Reach, reach out your hand and reach. I love it. I open up my arms and the tempest toss, coming from a land that's lost.
And as I live and breathe, I see the walls of hatred coming down.
If one
of your brothers becomes poor,
you shall open,
open wide your hand. If I could do one thing more, I'd reach into your
Dad is going to come up here. Aww. He sent it.
Surprise birthday party, and Madeline researched, went online and researched out a Dr. Stephen Gundry, which is the program I'm on, legal cake, and got all the ingredients, which I know were not easy to find, and made them the most beautiful cake. And I always remember Sally, who used to be a stalwart member here, and she and I loved cake. And I thought on Wednesday, which is my real birthday, I go, okay, I'm going to get through this birthday without any birthday cake and be proud of it.
That's a lot of cake. So.
And I have to apologize because I left the book of the month on my massage table at home. So I will not be pulling a name until next week. Stay tuned. I'm really sorry about that. But, yes, the song was perfect today, the Reach song, which I always love. Dennis, you're very talented. And so are your musicians that joined you. And it really does enhance our topic of our theme of the month, which is respecting other nations and people. And our topic today is combining that respect of other nations and people with gratitude for them. And anybody who's been around in our teaching for a while knows that we place a great value on gratitude as a spiritual practice, because we know it's so powerful. In fact, the spiritual leader for Centers for Spiritual Living, Dr. Ken Gordon. This is going to be fun. Are you testing me, God? He recently said, gratitude is the most powerful emotion in the world, and reminded us that through this practice, we energize that which we recognize and acknowledge as the good in our life. We energize it, and of course, this energizing result in us drawing and attracting even more good, greater good into our lives. And he also cautioned us that when we choose instead to dwell on the negative effects or conditions, we also energize them, which can lead to a creation of more disassociation or more separation. In the daily guide for July 30th in our SLM magazine, Science of Mind magazine, the two authors talked about being taught by their own spiritual leader to say yes to spirit, to say yes, thank you, more please, whenever they were engaged in a rich life experience. So they wrote, they said, whenever you find yourself in an experience that's making you really happy, you have this moment in consciousness to drink it all in, to feel what it feels like, and then tell yourself, conscious and spirit, this little prayer. Yes, thank you, more please. I love that. You'll anchor the feeling, you'll confirm the manifestation, you'll share the gratitude and celebration, and you'll direct the law with no choice but to respond and keep it coming, to answer that request. Yes, please. Yes, thank you. More, please. Yes, thank you. More, please. What an easy, wonderful prayer. We know here, most of us, that thanksgiving or gratitude is the fourth step of our spiritual mind treatment. And for those of you who are new to this teaching, spiritual mind treatment is a five-step formula, if you will, for affirmative prayer. And if you want to find out more about that, this is an advertisement. I'll be doing a 3-hour workshop next Saturday from 9 to 12 right here. Sign up on the back and come and find out more about how to make spiritual mind treatment an active practice in your life, because it is also very powerful. Why do we include gratitude in our prayer work? Because when we do so, we deepen our acceptance of the desired good that we are praying for as true. We're seeing it true in our lives right now by saying, thank you, thank you. And we're speaking the words of that prayer. When gratitude is expressed, the thoughts and feelings of having already received is impressed upon our mind. And this strong sense of acceptance engendered by gratitude is a very important element of spiritual mind treatment. When we accept something as already true, we know it is so, and we begin to act accordingly. So as a guiding practice, gratitude is the spiritual realization that all good has already been provided. In the Science of Mind text, Dr. Holmes writes, gratitude is one of the chief graces of human existence and is crowned in heaven with a consciousness of unity. It's that consciousness of unity that we strive for when we add gratitude and blessing of other nations and peoples to our spiritual outlook and practice. This prophetic justice principle, respect other people and nations, can be found uniquely expressed in Christian theology, and then we will translate it into our Science of Mind philosophy through the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman. And the account, brief account I'm going to share with you, comes from the Lanza Bible, which is a Bible that has been translated from the original language that Jesus spoke, which is Aramaic. So in this story, Jesus had left Judea and was traveling to Galilee. And in order to do that, he had to pass through Samaritan territory. And at that time, there was no consort between Jews and Samaritans. They just, and this is directly from the Bible now, the Lanza Bible. And there came a woman from Samaria to draw water. And Jesus said, give me water to drink. And the Samaritan woman said, how is it? You are a Jew, and yet you ask me for a drink. She's knowing that there's no consort between these two. But Jesus answered her, and he said to her, if you only knew the gift of God, and who is the man who said to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, my Lord, you have no leather bucket, you have no deep well. Where do you get the living water? Jesus answered, saying to her, everyone who drinks this water will thirst again, only to the well. But whoever drinks of the water which I give him shall never thirst. But the same water which I give him shall become in him a well of everlasting water, springing up to life. As Jesus continued to convey his message, the Samaritan woman came to realize that he was a prophet and a teacher, and she joined with other Samaritans who came to follow him. What did Jesus mean when he promised her living water? If we kind of examine this encounter with Jesus and the unnamed Samaritan woman, we might conclude that his promise demonstrated three things. One, God's love for all. Two, assurance or promise of a new day of peace to come. And three, the ability to imagine and create new possibilities. And this was begun when a Jew chose to speak to a Samaritan, even if it was to ask her for water. If we use the language of the Science of Mind, we might realize that the master teacher Jesus, through his metaphor of teaching waters or living waters, was expressing the nature of God and the infinite spirit of love which incarnates every person. Every person, regardless of this person's station in life, or what they're doing and demonstrating in their lives. And Jesus freely offered the living waters of grace to all that understood and embodied his message. He was preaching and promoting a consciousness of unity. In Words That Heal Today, Dr. Holmes wrote, Jesus knew the frailties of the human mind. Above and beyond these frailties, he knew of a divine power and a loving presence whose nature is to bless, the God of love who does not condemn. In the Science of Mind teachings, we recognize that the heart of humanity is a universal heartthrob. It pulsates at the center of every human being, and it is the place where, within each of us, where God has personalized itself as unconditional love. So when we keep gratitude for all humanity at the forefront of our spiritual practice, we're spreading unconditional love. Science of Mind has a universal concept of God. We think of living waters as the divine spirit that flows through everything, personalizing everything, adding warmth and color to everything. Spirit meets the spirit and communes with itself, even in our own ordinary conversations. And this all-inclusive attitude, which we choose to adopt and promote, is powerful in its ability to heal and to bless. Both Ernest Holmes and a man named Pierre Proterland are proponents of the practice of blessing, using the law of good, which is the givingness of spirit, in a more expanded way. Pierre Proterland is the author of a book called The Gentle Art of Blessing, and he reminds us that blessing and gratitude are both sides of the same coin. The author has been working in the areas of social justice for years, decades, in over 40 countries. And in his book, he tells the story of how he came to understand the power of the gentle art of blessing. He was contracted in Switzerland to develop a program to end hunger. And he was working specifically within the schools, and he adopted a catchphrase to promote his program. And other organizations that were promoting the end to hunger didn't like the phrase he was using and pretty much forced him to stop using it, and it ended up in a protracted kind of a challenge that ended up with him feeling that he had no other choice but to quit his job. And this led to, as you can imagine, feelings of really deep resentment toward the people who he felt was responsible for this decision. And he likened this growing resentment to a rat that gnaws at your entrails. I was like, that is so vivid. And it's true. He knew that carrying this resentment around would be harmful to his physical and his mental well-being. But despite his persistent attempts to heal it through prayer and meditation, he just felt really stuck in this resentment. Until one day, when he was reading from his Bible, and he was reading the Sermon on the Mount, and he came across Jesus' instructions to bless those who curse you. And you might say he had an aha moment. And he was like, He was contemplating what he felt to be a revealed commandment, and he said, oh, this is so simple. All I need to do is bless these people. And that is what he began to do. Every day he would consciously bless his enemies, and he would send them blessings of health, joy, and love, and abundance, anything he could think of, just wishing that for them in all their affairs. And he continued to do so, devoted to this spiritual practice, though he admitted it did take him 3 years to completely let go of any and all resentment. He felt that it was more than worth it, because with his eventual healing also came this realization that he had so much to be grateful for, because he could now judge an experience that he once thought as devastating as one that opened his eyes to a healing practice that changed his life. Once, what he once described as obedience to a revealed commandment soon moved from his head to his heart, and blessing others became a life-enhancing practice that he began to apply universally. He soon began to bless people all over, in the post office line, in the grocery store line. He traveled a lot on trains, and he would make it a practice to walk the entire length of the train and back and in so doing, silently blessing everybody on each side of the aisle. What a beautiful spiritual practice. And then he began to spread the word because he was feeling so much joy through this practice that he began to spread the word in his writings and to his friends through his communications, and talked about the blessings he was receiving from employing the gentle art of blessing. And he was gratified when people would contact him and say, hey, I tried it, and it really works. It really works. So he came to understand that blessing others was not just confined to the scripted liturgical practices of priests and other clergy. He soon understood that blessing is a transformational practice that can be used by anyone with a sincere heart. He believes, and he thought about it, and he pondered it, and he thought, blessings must have sprung up simultaneously within prehistoric society as a way of thanking the awesome and mysterious natural forces that they felt shaped their lives. He defines blessing as simply sending love energy from the heart to any situation or person. And he was especially inspired to continue this when he read the Aramaic translation of Jesus' commandment, which changed the accepted translation from love thy neighbor as thyself to love thy neighbor who is thyself. In his book, The Gentle Art of Blessing, Prater writes, to bless is to acknowledge the omnipotent universal beauty from material eyes. It is to activate that law of attraction, which from the furthest reaches of the universe will bring to your life exactly what you need to experience and enjoy. The practice of blessing is a simple way to develop a consciously centered awareness. It's a tool for growing universal love, and also for avoiding judgment. He said to bless all without distinction is the ultimate form of giving, because those you bless will never know from where came that sudden ray that burst through the cloud of their skies. And you'll rarely be a witness to the sunlight in their lives. It's impossible, he says, to bless and judge at the same time. So he continues his practice of blessing everyone in his immediate world. But more importantly, he also includes daily blessings to our world leaders who in the world of appearances have contributed greatly to conflict and torture and abuse. Among those he blesses on a daily basis are Assad, president of Syria, and Kim, Donald's friend from North Korea, and our own, of course, esteemed president is included in his daily blessings. One of the things that enables him to do this is his firm belief that everyone at every moment is operating at their highest level of consciousness. If they could do better, they would. If they could operate on a higher level, they would. And one of the ways that we help them to move to a higher level is through the blessing and conferring of love. You may have heard me say before, and this is the God's truth, every time I think of Mr. Trump, I now say, I bless you and I release you to your highest good. But I have yet to include other world leaders in my blessings. This is kind of an inspiring thought to me. I think I'm going to try it. And he definitely has me beat in the art of blessing because he's learned to preface his blessings with the phrase, I love you and I bless you. He feels that anyone can confer a blessing with little emotion. It might be devoid of emotion, but when you add that love quotient to it, you're tapping into that universal spread of unconditional love that is indeed possible. So I may not be quite yet ready to say I love you and mean it when I'm blessing those who raise my hackles and continually break open my heart with actions against humanity. But I can be willing to entertain the motion. I can be willing to move toward that ability to add I love you to my blessings. And I'm thinking about the two mass shootings that just occurred, and how easy it is to bless all of the people that were affected and all of their relatives and to send love and light. but how difficult it is to bless the shooters. Something to work toward. But you know what? I like the simplicity of this practice because we can all easily engage in it. It doesn't take much to add to the practice of blessing into our day. I've been thinking a lot about this and I've been practicing it. And most recently, yesterday morning, when I was coming home from my early morning meeting, I said, I'm going to bless everybody I pass on the roads. Everybody I pass, I said it out loud. I bless you and I send you love. I bless you and I send you love. I don't know how it affected them, but I do know how it affected me. It made me happy. It made me feel joy. It's a simple practice. I think about our friend Pete. I know he's out. Where are you, Pete? He's out there somewhere. I saw him. Yeah. Pete always says, there he is. I just throw some love at people who need it. in his Pete voice. But you know, what he is doing is he's consciously conferring blessings where he feels blessings are needed. And who doesn't need a little love? Who cannot benefit from some love being thrown their way? I love it. And we know, again, I'm going to quote Mother Teresa, because we may not be able to take monumental action that will change the course of world events, but every one of us can do small things with great love, as Mother Teresa said. And I do agree that blessing and gratitude are two sides of the same coin. Using Pratervan's example, once he had fully engaged in the practice of blessing those he considered to be his enemies, his perception about his situation changed. And he was able to feel gratitude for the new pathways of the heart that opened up for him as he released his anger and his resentment. If we really believe that there is only one of us here, we can't help but understand how the love that we send out contributes to the healing of our world in ways that we may never even see or feel. That's where faith comes in, the faith that as I do this, adding to the healing of the world. And likewise, the practice, the daily practice, the hourly practice of gratitude for all the beauty, joy, kindness, and abundance that we are privy to in our lives, can only create more of the same, more to be grateful for, not just in our lives, but in the lives of others. Dr. Holmes reminds us, we live unto others. We live unto others because that which is myself is yourself. That which is yourself and myself is myself. And that which is ourself collectively and ourselves individually is the one and only self there is. There is no other self. So I must be going, wait a minute, I think I've heard these words before. I am he, as you are me, and we are all together. I am the walrus. I'm not sure whether the Beatles or Ernest Holmes figured this out first, but we all know it's the truth. That's right. Look at you. We all know that we are all united, at least those of us sitting here. We're all united in the one mind we call God. And out of that changeless unity, brings forth infinite variation. The concept of oneness with all people and the understanding of what that means in our teaching is central to our practice of faith in God, the source of everything. And how that belief is implemented and observed on a personal level can come through the actions we take to address social issues. When we stop distinguishing ourselves and our country from the others, and begin to unite in the consciousness of oneness, we evolve and the collective consciousness is raised. I just saw a tiny example of this morning when I was quickly looking at the news on my phone and saw that a man had apologized to Barack Obama on his birthday for the hatred that he had spread before he had changed his mind and learned something different. He said, when I was a conservative, was the way he put it. When I was supporting President Trump, I put out a lot of hatred, and I'm apologizing for that right now. I've changed the way I think. That's one tiny thing, but it's like throwing a stone and watching the ripples spread. So we're all challenged to find ways to transform our society to be more caring, more democratic, more respectful. People of faith are called upon to find the courage to speak truth to power. To our leaders, when we see evidence of injustice in our communities, and that's happening more and more, more and more, we're being asked to walk our talk as well as talk our walk from the heart level. So our social activists can manifest in two ways. It can manifest in a public outward involvement, or it can manifest through persistent and consistent attention to prayer, gratitude, and blessing others. Both of these actions are going to elevate the awareness of things that need to be changed and also contribute to the fulfillment of these changes being made. There is no separation. Either one you choose to do is going to be powerful and dynamic, and if you choose to do both, wow. Our oneness in life connects each of us to all of us. Cultivating and practicing the art of gratitude and blessing and extending and receiving grace can serve all of us in ways that are so positive. So this is my call to action for the rest of the month. I'm inviting each and every one of you to practice blessing anything and everything every day. If you're not ready to tackle blessing our esteemed world leaders, then bless that neighbor who's been bugging you. Or bless that traffic that seems to stop you in your tracks. You can always find something to begin blessing, and you know that blessing keeps us mindful to keep our word positive and not negate the good that we are calling forth. We know that in the long term, many issues may take a good while for the transforming effect to be seen. But we've seen this transforming effect. We've seen it in women's rise to power. We've seen it in more acceptance of gay rights. And you know, we've seen tiny steps that lead to bigger steps. We can make this happen. Keep the faith and keep on blessing with a grateful heart. It must make a difference. It does make a difference. So I want you to end this talk with you affirmingly with me, if you will. As I go through my day, I recognize that I am one with all people everywhere.
And activities
to support our living in peace, happiness, prosperity, and justice.
Time for conscious giving.